Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now, here's a message from Pastor Dan Roth.
Father, we come to you in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we're grateful tonight to come into your house, come into your presence, God. Lord, we thank you for what you've already done. Thank you for the miracles that took place at this altar, God. Heaven only knows the fullness of what happened, God. And Lord, on earth, we will do our best to tell your testimony of the things that took place here tonight. God, I thank you for healings and provisions and miracles, signs and wonders, God. Lord, we praise you and thank you for the power of your Spirit and the power of the name of Jesus that we exalt in this place. Now, Lord, as we open up your word, God, we expect no less. God, we want to go farther with you. We want to go deeper. We ask, God, that you would come and speak to our hearts, Lord. Open us up to receive it. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, our hearts to have a good understanding. May we be the good ground where the word is sown. May it produce something in each and every one of our individual lives. Truly, tonight, we didn't come to hear from a man or a woman. Didn't come to hear from the young or the old. Didn't come to hear from a black man, white man, brown man, tall man, short man, God. Doesn't matter what men have to say. We don't want to hear the ideas and philosophies of man, God. We want to hear from you. We acknowledge tonight that the Holy Spirit is the teacher of the church. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Be our teacher. Be our guide. Give us the vision, the wisdom, the instruction, the direction, even the correction we need for our lives. And Lord, we'll give you the praise, give you the glory, and give you the honor. God, we don't just ask this blessing upon ourselves, also we'd ask it for all the churches that are both here in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet. They're our brothers and sisters, Lord. At no time do we think of ourselves as any better than them. We see ourselves as co-laborers and workers together in your field, building your kingdom to the glory of God. So, Lord, we'd ask that you bless all of the Baptists, Lutherans, Methodists, Episcopalians, Charismatics, Pentecostals. God, we thank you for Calvary Chapel, Harvest, for Oak Valley, for The Way, God, for Ecclesia and Trinity and Emmanuel Baptist, God, all the great churches that are out there, too many to name by name, God. We ask that you bless our Catholic brothers and sisters and Adventist brothers and sisters, Lord. We would ask, God, that you bless the assemblies in the Four Square denominations, God, and Victory and Crossroads, God, all the great churches that are out there, Lord. If they're preaching your gospel, lifting up the name of Jesus, we bless them as you would bless us. God, we also don't forget our persecuted brothers and sisters scattered abroad throughout the earth, Lord. We ask that you protect them, provide for them, encourage them, strengthen them. God, may they endure to the end. And Lord, we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, we're all in agreement. And we say,
amen.
Amen. Get your Bibles and go with me tonight. To 2 Chronicles chapter number 20. 2 Chronicles chapter number 20. A while ago, I started something that when I'm in the pulpit on Wednesday nights, I'm going to just be kind of flowing in the same theme, okay? But each one of the messages that I flow in that theme will all have distinct emphasis. And so don't worry tonight if you miss part one of this. This message stands alone, and so you'll be able to get this. And online, it's absolutely free if you want to hear part one. But I'm calling this train of thought, this series, Distractions from Destiny. Last time we were together, we talked about the distraction of sin and how sin is a slippery slope. In fact, it's a tar pit. And as we get into sin, sin can literally take us away from our destiny. Tonight, I have a part two, but before I get to that, I just want to read a couple of things called Christian breakup lines. Okay? And I'll tell you the reason why I want to read these in a little bit. Relevant Magazine actually polled their readers online and asked them to send them some of the best Christian breakup lines that they could find. And so, you know, they had the, you know, I just don't want to be unequally yoked and some of those things. But I chose three that I thought were just gems, okay? And I want to read them to you tonight. Here's one from a guy. He says, a girlfriend suggested I read I Kiss Dating Goodbye by Joshua Harris. I didn't take the hint for a few months. Thought that was funny. You guys get it? You should read I Kissed Dating Goodbye. Okay, you get it, but it's not funny. I get it. All right, I'm tracking with you. I like this one. A guy says, I dated a Catholic girl. I'm not Catholic. She told me she needed to be closer to God, so she broke up with me by giving me up for Lent. I thought that was a good one. And then the third one, I like this one. Rather than it's not you, it's me, these words were whispered to me, but they echoed in the room as she spoke them. It's not you, it's God. Why would I read Christian breakup lines? Because I think one of the distractions and one of the greatest distractions in our life comes from people. A distraction from destiny could be the people in our lives, and we have to be very careful. And it could be that you might need to utilize, it's not you, it's God, or maybe one of these other breakup lines with people in your life. And the reason why I say that is not to be mean-spirited, not to tell you that you have to clear out all of your friends and just be you and God. No, we need people in our lives, and we need to have godly relationships. We need people around us who will encourage us and who will walk with us. And we're going to talk about that tonight. But people can distract us from where God is bringing us. And it's very important who we surround ourselves with. I had you turn to 2 Chronicles chapter number 20. We'll get there in a second. But I want to just quote to you 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33. I'll put it up on the overheads. He says, "Do not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits." So you could have been a Christian for a long time. And you could be involved in godly activities on a regular basis. Notice the word habits. Sometimes we get down on habits. Habits are things like I wake up in the morning and the first thing I do is I pray. Habits are things like I make it a point that I'm going to get into the Word of God every day. Maybe it's before you go to bed or maybe it's at your lunch break. Habits are, you know, when I see a certain thing, I remember to talk to God about that thing. You know, there's some things that are good godly habits. Routines are not all bad. You know, sometimes we say, well, I got to break the routines. I get that. I understand that. I agree with that. And yet there are some habits in our lives that are godly, and certain things that we don't need to let go of. Prayer, studying the Word, being in the things of God, witnessing, being in church, those are things that are good for our lives, and the stability of those things carries us through the rest of what's going on around us. And so we are not to be deceived. In other words, the devil would like to deceive us with this stuff because he is the deceiver. And therefore, we are to know this in advance so that we will not be deceived. Evil company corrupts good habits. In other words, if we allow certain people into our lives on a regular, consistent basis, that habit that was godly, the things that we were doing consistently, eventually we will be taken off course. Why? Because there's a person in our life that's a distraction from destiny. Sometimes it comes in the form of a girlfriend or a boyfriend, you know, believing God for that godly spouse. And, you know, you're looking all around and you're trying to stay focused on God. And then some pretty little thing or some handsome chiseled dude comes along. And all of a sudden, here we are. And whereas before it was all about God and I'm following the Lord and I want this godly person in my life, then all of a sudden you find yourself compromised and in a situation you didn't think you'd be in. Sometimes it comes in the form of an old friend who was out of your life for a long time, and then suddenly they reconnect, and they're like, hey, where are you, man? You used to be in the scene, and I thought that this was how it was going down. I thought we'd be, you know, together forever, and you're saying, no, I found the Lord, and you know, the Lord found me, and we're in love, and you feel like, you know, oh, man, we had such good times together. I don't want to abandon them. And so you start hanging out and just have one drink, man. It's not a big deal. Come on, you used to be cool. Oh, I guess I can do it. I guess, you know, they need to know that Christians aren't stiffs. And next thing they're offering you a toke. And next thing they're offering. And see, it can be something to where bad company can corrupt good morals, good habits, and can take you off of your destiny. We see this in the life of a man by the name of Jehoshaphat. Maybe some of you guys were here this week and you remember we were talking about this guy. Kind of a funny name. But Jehoshaphat, we find him in 2 Chronicles chapter number 20. He was a good guy. He loved the Lord. In fact, he delighted himself in the Lord. But we see a principle here, and that principle is this. The people in our lives will steer us towards or away from our God-given destiny. Okay? The people in our lives, I have it up on the overheads for you, will steer us towards or away from our God-given destiny. And we're going to talk about how to determine who those people to steer you towards your God-given destiny are later on tonight. But it's very important that we know this right up front, because everyone in our life is almost like, you know, you guys used to play pinball, right? And you have those little hammers and those little things that slap the ball, right? Friends and people in your life are people who should be ones that when you come in contact with them, they propel you into your God-given destiny. But the wrong people are like those little circle things that just bat you around, you know, and you kind of just ding, 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 and you don't really go anywhere. You know what I'm saying? So we need to understand that people are somebody that are very important in our life. We need to surround ourselves with the right people because we don't need distractions from destiny. We need to be catapulted towards our destiny. And a good friend will do that for you. Jehoshaphat, in 2 Chronicles chapter number 20, starting in verse number 35, talks about all the great things that Jehoshaphat did, talks about his life. And then in verse number 35, it says this, after this, Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, allied himself with Ahaziah, king of Israel. Now everybody say, allied himself. Some of the older translations say, joined himself. In other words, this was something that they connected. There was a deeper connection. He allied himself with Ahaziah, king of Israel. Look at this. Who acted very wickedly. Ahaziah had come from a long line of wicked kings, and Ahaziah himself was a very wicked king. And so here's Jehoshaphat, someone who delighted themselves in the ways of the Lord, somebody who had a divine destiny, somebody who had the prosperity in the hand of God on his life, but yet now he allies himself with the wrong guy. Now look at what happens. It says, verse 36, and he allied himself with him to make ships to go to Tarshish. And they made ships in Ezion-Geber. Now, for all of us, we look at that and go, so what? They're making ships? Who cares? Now, the guy's bad, but this is just a business deal. This is just something that, you know, they could have been they're not joining their people together. They're not bowing down to their gods. What's the big deal? He allied himself. He joined himself to this man, Ahaziah. And then here they are, and they get into business together. Now, Solomon, with the wisdom that God had given him, had done the same thing. You can read about it in your Bible. Solomon had ships that went to Tarshish. And they went and they picked up all kinds of goods and spices and monkeys and gold and all sorts of stuff, right? Yeah, monkeys, really. And so here's a king that's coming later on who wants prosperity in the kingdom. He wants to bring in goods. And in fact, they go to the same place Solomon was at to build the ships. So it's not a problem with the business plan because Solomon already had this business plan. He had already prospered with this business plan. And yet, let's take a look at what happened, because two times now we see he allied himself with this wicked king in two verses. Very important that we understand that, because God is not mixing words. God is showing us he allied himself with the wicked king. He allied himself to do business. Now let's look at the outcome. Verse 37, but Eleazar, son of Dodavah of Merashah, prophesied against Jehoshaphat, saying, because you have allied yourself with Ahaziah, the Lord has destroyed your works. Then the ships were wrecked so that they were not able to go to Tarshish. Wow. In other words, God says, because. In other words, if you would not have done this, if you would have just went and built the ships yourself, gold, here comes the spices. Here come the monkeys, right? Never thought you'd hear that in a sermon, huh? And so, but because you've done foolishly, because you've allied yourself with the wrong person, the ships were wrecked. And in our lives, we need to recognize and realize that we don't want to be shipwrecked on the path to our destiny. We want to be a people that, like the Apostle Paul, doesn't matter if I'm in the deep for 3 nights, 3 days, right? God will still bring me to the shore. God will still take me to my destiny. God will still take me to my purpose. Why? Because I've got the right people around me. Come on, somebody. Are you guys listening tonight? Now, the Apostle Paul expands on this for us, talks about our position, okay? And I want to clarify some things with believers and with unbelievers. Turn me to the book of 1 Corinthians now. New Testament, 1 Corinthians. We're going to be in chapter number 5, okay? 1 Corinthians. Chapter number 5, okay? Now, let me give you a little bit of history while we're turning to 1 Corinthians. The Corinthian church was all messed up, okay? Can I put it to you like that? They had a guy in their church who was sleeping with his mother. Pretty gross, huh? And yet they were proud about it. They paraded this guy around, his father's wife. And so here they are, and they're talking about this, and the Apostle Paul says to them in a letter, he says, I don't want you guys being around the sexually immoral. Now, they didn't get it, okay? They were still need a lot of instruction. They need a lot of correction, just like we do. Hello? Okay? And so here they are, and he's correcting them. He's telling them some things. And he says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse number 6, he says, your glorying is not good. He says, you guys should not be proud of this. This is sinful, this is wrong, and you guys should not be involved in this. Your glorying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Now, what's he talking about, leaven? We know what that is. That's an agent that you put inside of dough to cause it to rise, right? You don't need a lot of leaven. You only need a little bit of leaven, and you knead that into the dough, and as you do, eventually, it continues to expand, and the air bubbles and the pockets start to go in, and now all of a sudden, that dough begins to rise. Just a little bit of leaven leavens the whole lump. Do you know that most of the time when you read in your Bible, you will find that leaven was an evil thing? In fact, the Apostle Paul goes on, we won't read through it tonight just for time's sake, but he goes on to talk about Jesus as our Passover lamb. And on the Passover, they were to take brooms and sweep their houses and get all of the leaven out. Why? Because it was symbolic that they were getting rid of the ways of the world. Because there was the leaven of Egypt, there was the leaven of the Pharisees that Jesus talked about, right? Beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. In other words, just a little bit of the Pharisees' doctrine. If you surround yourself with these people, a little bit of leaven will leaven the whole lump. So now here's the Apostle Paul writing to the Corinthians, and he says, a little bit of leaven, if you allow a little bit of sinfulness around you, if you ally yourself and you surround yourself with the wrong people, their influence will go all through your life, and it'll rip through your church if you keep putting up with it and you keep celebrating sinful things. Now, he goes on, okay, and drop down, and he says this in verse number 9. Okay, let's pick it back up in verse number 9. He says, I wrote to you in my epistle or my letter not to keep company with sexually immoral people. Verse 10, yet I certainly did not mean with the sexually immoral people of this world or with the covetous or with extortioners or idolaters, since then you would need to go out of the world. In other words, he says, you guys, you're not getting it. I told you not to hang around with the sexually immoral people, but I wasn't talking about that you would shun people out there in the world. No, our attitude towards people in the world is that we are to be a witness to them and we are to show the love of Jesus to them. He says, otherwise, if you didn't associate with any sinner, you would just have to get out of the whole world because there's sinners everywhere, right? They're all around us. We are surrounded, okay, on the job, on the streets, everywhere. So he says, you'd have to be just completely removed out of the world. But yet, God did not zap us out of here when we got saved. So we know we're still here for a reason. So he says, it's not so that we can shun unbelievers and just be the holy huddle of us for no more. No, we need to be welcoming. We need to be loving. We need to reach out to them. But remember, the wisdom says that because I'm spiritual and because I'm no longer a sinner, that I'm not going to ally myself in close fellowship and friendship with people in the world, but not to completely disassociate. You guys get the difference? Okay, because sometimes people get confused. Well, do I have to give up my old friends? You don't have to give them up. You need to reach out to them. You need to show the love of Jesus to them. But you don't need to have them as intimate and close friends in that sense. Because now, remember, spiritually, things are discerned spiritually. And the carnal mind cannot accept those things. So if you're bearing your heart, you're not going to get spiritual advice from them. Having trouble in your marriage, you go to somebody who doesn't understand the things of God, they'll tell you just divorce them. Why? Because they understand only the natural. Oh, if you're unhappy in your marriage, you can't work it out. I guess it's irreconcilable differences. You should leave. Go find somebody who you're more compatible with. If you're single and you just sense, man, my goodness, I need to stay pure, but I just have this desire on the inside of me and I'm just, there. And you go talk to one of your friends, they'll tell you, why don't you go try it out? You wouldn't even buy a car if you didn't drive it before. Hello? Why? Because they think naturally. You need to sleep with a woman before you marry her. You need to sleep with a guy before you marry him. You need to make sure you're sexually compatible. See, that's a natural way of looking at it. Yet in the spiritual, it says, no, you don't do that until you're married because it's covenant. It's much deeper. It's an intimate agreement. And when you join yourself to somebody, now the two become one flesh. So I'm not going to join myself to a whole bunch of people. Now all of a sudden I'm tied to everybody. No, now in the spirit now I recognize and realize, okay, I can't do that. So that's where you don't disassociate, you don't completely cut people off and shun them, right? You witness to them, you love them, but they're not your close friends, okay? But now he switches over to people in the church. Take a look at what he says. Verse number 11, but now I have written to you not to keep company with anyone named a brother. Everybody say named a brother. Named a brother. That means people who call themselves Christians. Remember, we're talking about people can be a distraction from your divine destiny. God has you on a path. God has a plan for your life. And yet people, even well-meaning good people in the church, can be a distraction if we're not careful. Because if they're named a brother, look at anyone named a brother who is sexually immoral. In other words, they're unrepentant in their sin. There's people like that in church. He goes on to say, or covetous, or an idolater, or a reviler, or a drunkard, or an extortioner, not even to eat with such a person. See, we figure, well, wait, it's just lunch. We're just hanging out. What could be the harm in that? But remember, a little bit of leaven leavens the whole lot. Very important who you surround yourself with. Very important who you join yourself to. That's why, we endeavor at this church to surround ourselves and build godly relationships within the church. And we want to make sure, and we're watching out. That's why if you ever hear of, you know, the church is so mean, they took so-and-so out of being a small group leader. There's a reason why. Because we're watching after your soul. And we have to give an account before God of what we do. And of your lives, and we need to make sure. The Bible says, savage wolves will rise up from among you. They're in the church, guys. Pastor Luke was talking about the wheat and the tares Sunday night. Remember what the Lord said? He said, don't rip them up, don't uproot them. That means that there in church will be people who can distract you from your divine destiny. Why? Because the Lord is not removing them because he doesn't want to uproot the wheat with the tares. So he says, let them grow together. We all need to be mature enough to understand that's how churches are. That's why when you wonder why there's hypocrites in church, that's why. Part of the reason. The other part of the reason is God's not finished with us yet. Can I get an amen from anybody? All right? So, very important. And then he goes on to say, for what do I have to do with judging those who are outside? No, we don't judge people outside. God is their judge. God will deal with them. God will take care of them. We witness to them. We love them. But in the church, we need to understand that there are going to be people who, if we're not careful, will distract us from our divine destiny. Watch the fruit of their lives. Now, if you're married, I have to put this in here. Because I don't want you walking out of this place today saying, well, Pastor Dan said I have to be careful about who I let in my life, and you're just toxic. And so I'm gone, or you're gone. No, if you're married, you're yoked, all right? You're together. That's it, okay? Now let me give you some encouragement, all right? 1 Peter chapter number 3, okay? Now, a lot of times we give this set of verses to the women where it says that just, hey, submit to your husbands as unto the Lord, right? And as you do, he will see by your chaste conduct and your good words. He without a word will read the word in you, basically. And it's not about the outward adornment. It's about the inner man of the heart, which is very precious in the sight of the Lord, okay? Now, then there comes a word right after that. It says, likewise, you men also dwell with your wives with understanding, okay? Now, I know in the natural mind, the men say, well, how could any man understand a woman? You know, that's just like crazy, God. You know, we just can't do that. But here's the deal. What is God saying? That word likewise is a very important word. In other words, in the same way that the women are going to have a quiet spirit, submit themselves to their husbands, and allow the word of God to come through them, in the same way, husbands, dwell with them with understanding. Understanding what? Understanding that you guys are in this together. Understanding that she needs the word through you in a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of the Lord. Understanding that God can work those issues out, especially if you guys are believers, okay? If you guys are believers, then it's time to get in faith. It's time to start loving by faith. It's time to start declaring over your husband that I love that man and I submit to him as the church does to Christ and everything, right? And if you're a husband looking at your wife, I love that woman and I lay down my life as Christ loved the church. I sacrifice myself and my needs, my desires, my wants for her needs, her desires, her wants. I cherish her. I will nourish her as Christ does the church. See, you start declaring those things and then you start doing them. Start putting legs to your faith. Not only speaking it, but also doing it. Start looking for opportunities to serve. Start looking for opportunities to love. Now, if you are here today alone, and you are a believer, but your husband or wife is an unbeliever, okay? Again, the Apostle Paul gives us some encouragement in that area. He says, if they're willing to stay, let them stay. You don't know if they'll be won by your conduct later on. And so he says, if they want to go, let them go. That's one thing. But if they want to stay, then hey, let them stay. I've heard reports and testimonies of men and women who have come to this church believing God for their spouse. And they didn't even know they were coming to church here live. And online, their spouse was watching online, and they didn't want to let their spouse know because they were like, I got to check this place out first, you know. And God was working on them. And so they secretly watched the Rock services for a period of time. And eventually, they came to church, gave their heart and life to Jesus, and now they're together serving the Lord. Okay? So I got to throw that in there because if you're married, you're married. Hello, okay? Come on, somebody. All right? So this is not, Pastor Dan's approval to leave or to, you know, beat someone up or anything like that. No, you stick together. You stay in there. You stay in faith. 1 Peter chapter 3, get a hold of it and work that in your lives, and it will change where you live. So how do we choose the right people in our life? How do I choose the right company? Well, let me start this out with a story. There were two guys that were hunting up in Alaska. As they're hunting, they're in the tent, and they've got all their gear, and they're getting ready, and they just strapped on their hiking boots. They've got their guns and their jackets and everything. They're ready to go, and they step out, and as they step out, the first one stops the second one behind him, and he just points up the road ahead. There is the biggest grizzly bear they have ever seen in their lives. And the second guy stops and sinks back into the tent, takes off his boots, and pulls out some track shoes and starts putting on some running shoes. And the first guy looks at the second guy and says, "What are you doing? Don't you know you can't outrun a bear?" Second guy says, "I don't have to outrun the bear. All I have to do is outrun you." Very important who we surround ourselves with, okay? Someone who's going to run with you and not leave you in the dust. So how do I choose the right company? First of all is this. Make sure that they aren't just kiss-ups. Be very cautious about people who only compliment you. Okay, we like those people. We like having them around us. Everyone likes that. Everyone likes yes. But make sure that if you've got a real friend, a real person in your life, make sure they're not just a kiss up. Okay? Because we don't need shallow relationships. We don't need people who won't tell us the truth. That's been our commitment to you as pastors for over 27 years, is that we will tell you like it is. If you got something in your nose, we're going to point it out. Okay? If there's something in your teeth, we're going to say, hey, you know, spiritually speaking, of course. But make sure people aren't just kiss-ups around you. Make sure that they're not just playing patty cake with you. Plutarch said this. He said, "I don't need a friend who changes when I change and who nods when I nod. My shadow does that much better." I could hire somebody to walk around and tell me how wonderful I am. But that doesn't make it a meaningful relationship, and it doesn't make me any better, and it doesn't help me on my destiny. There are times when we need to hear the word no. There are times when we need to hear something different than ourselves. There are times where we need to make sure that we have people in our lives who aren't just kiss-ups. Look at what Proverbs chapter 27, turn with me to the book of Proverbs. We're going to be in the book of Proverbs for the rest of the night. Proverbs chapter number 27, love this verse. And in Proverbs chapter number 27, take a look at verse number 6. Proverbs chapter 27, verse number 6 says this. It says, "Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful." Kiss-ups, they're just pulling your leg. They're just playing games. And you don't need to surround yourself with the kiss-ups because you will have a very shallow relationship. and it won't make you any better. But look at this. See that first word? Faithful. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. No one likes being wounded. No one likes being hurt. No one likes hearing no. No one likes those things. No one likes a sharp response that goes against what we wanted. And yet, the wounds of a friend are faithful. That's how you know this person can be in my life, because they're faithful. They're not just being me just to get near to me. They're being them. And as we come together, if they wound me, if they hurt me, man, those are a faithful wound. It's like those scars that you have that you say, you know, I got this one wrestling, or I got this one when I was learning to ride a bike, you know, and you could point it out. If I could open up my heart to you guys tonight, I could show you scars where there were people in my life that told me, listen, you're not all that. Faithful wound. I needed that. Thank you. Thank you for chopping down my pride. I needed that. Yes. Glory to God. I could show you wounds where, hey, not like that, like this. Those are great wounds to have, because I thought I was doing it right, and yet someone came along and showed me a better way. Someone showed me the more excellent way. There were things that I had or things that I believed, and someone came along and, no, that's not right. It's not the way it is. We need people in our lives who aren't just kiss-ups, but who will tell us the truth and love us enough to tell us the truth. Just speak plain and just tell me like it is. Show me where I got stuff in my teeth. I'll go get some floss. Lawrence J. Peter said, you can always tell a real friend when you made a fool of yourself and he doesn't feel you've done a permanent job. I like that. Because I've made a fool of myself, and there's people still around me, and I just so appreciate my wife, who's one of those people who makes me better. Which brings us to the second one, is this. If you're going to surround yourself with the right people, make sure that you're better when they're around. In other words, not only do they correct you, but just by who they are, you just want to be better, right? There's certain people that they can just walk into a room and everybody stands at attention, right? Shoulders back, heads up. You walk a little taller. Why? Because they're in the room, right? That's my boy. That's my girl. That's my friend. They're somebody that I want to be better because they're in the place. You know, I so appreciate the teaching team here. I'm better because of Pastor Luke. I'm better because of Pastor Jim. I'm better because of Pastor Deborah. They challenge me, not by challenging me, even though they have, right? And they've been those first people that are not kiss-ups, not just tell me, Dan, you're so sweet and wonderful, right? And they'll tell you like it is, okay? You're dumb, don't do that, you know? That's just how it is, okay? And you can imagine family dinners, all right? So that's one side. But the other side is this, is that when I get around these people, man, it makes me want to be better. When I hear the wisdom that pour out of their mouths, I go, my goodness, I got to step up my game. And in all of our lives, we need people who have gone farther. Maybe they're ahead of us. Maybe they're ahead of us in years. Maybe they're ahead of us in experience. Maybe they're not. But man, when I get around them, I just feel like, gosh, I got to be better. You know, I'm a musician. I like playing music and study music, all that kind of stuff. I remember I started playing Wednesday nights here at The Rock, and I was playing guitar. And man, I'd get around Cameron shaking his dreads, and there were some other guys that were around. And man, it was like you start playing a song, and you just look around, and you'd want to just take off the guitar and walk away, because it's like, you guys are crazy. You're on a whole nother level. And yet these guys, they would just say, no, come over here. Come on, just right here. Right here is where you live, white boy. Go for it. This is a gospel song. You do this, you know? It's okay to shake your head a little bit and get after it, all right, you know? And so, yeah, you know, it was people that just made me better. People that we have in our lives, you know, at work, you should take a look and see, you know, don't get mad at the person that's the star of the month or whatever it is, employee of the month. Don't get mad at them. Go find out what they're doing that's so good. Am I right? You know, if you're in church and somebody blesses you, go find out what they're putting their hand to. If an usher blessed you and you're an usher, man, my goodness, why not sign up and volunteer and say, I want to serve under them for a little while and see what makes them so, see what made them make me want to be better. What is it that they have a hold of that I can get a hold of? You know, and get around those people. My goodness, there's tons of them here in this church. You're there in Proverbs. Proverbs this time, chapter number 27, verse number 17, okay? Drop down to verse number 17. Look at what it says. As iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of his friend. See, we need to get around people, and when we interact, right, we leave sharper, not duller. See, if you're dull, that means they were just a big blunt instrument that you kind of collided with, right? But if you come in contact with the right people, if you surround yourself with the right people, every time you come in contact with them, you leave a little bit sharper. You leave a little bit better. You leave smoother, more effective. Man, you're able to do more with less effort. Why? Because I was around them. Last one for tonight is this. How do I choose the right company? Is that you see the outcome of their life. If they're producing fruit, if you can see the outcome of their faith, if you not only hear them talking the talk, but you can see them walking the walk, and you see fruit behind them, then you know that could be somebody that I want to surround myself with. Not a kiss up. I'm better when they're around, but also I see the outcome of their life. Wisdom is known by her children, the Bible says. Is that right? If they're producing godly fruit from wise decisions, then you know that I can be around them. Because why? Their fruit has shown me that they are wise. Okay? Once again, the book of Proverbs, we'll close with this tonight. Proverbs chapter 13 this time. Proverbs chapter number 13 and verse number 20. Proverbs chapter number 13, verse 20 says this. It says, he who walks with wise men will be wise. But the companion of fools will be destroyed. Now you say, well, how do I know who's wise and who's a fool? We already said that, right? Fruit. You look at their lives because wisdom is proven by her children. So if I look at somebody's life and they're successful, if I look at somebody's life and they have a great relationship with the Lord, if I look at somebody's life and they have a great marriage, if I look at somebody's life and I see that their children are serving the Lord and they're in order, if I look at somebody's life and I see that their life is not in shambles, they're not a mess, then I can look at their fruit of their lives and say they have made wise decisions. And he who walks with the wise will himself be wise. Why? Because you're hanging out and because when you're around them, they call out greatness in you. Something's better because they're around. They're sharpening you. Why? Because also they're not a kiss up. Because they're going to tell you, hey, this is what I've seen in my life. This is where I've gone. This is what I've done. Yeah, I had that trouble in my marriage. This is how we overcame. Yeah, I had that same problem with my boss. And you know what happened? I did this. See, if you walk with the wise, wisdom just pours forth from them. Wisdom will come out of a wise person. When they open their mouth, it's not just to mess around. It's not just a patty cake. It's not just to kiss up. It's what's coming from a real heart. And you will only know that when you see the fruit of their life. But you'll know the fools too. Why? Because they're going to be the ones that are losing their jobs. They're going to be the ones that are losing their marriage. They're going to be the ones that as you look at their life, they're a mess. If you ask their children, what do you think about dad or mom? And they tell you, ooh, no. Come on. Just ask the kids. Kids will tell you the truth. My kids tell the truth all the time. Sometimes I wish they didn't because I'm like, son, that could hurt somebody's feelings, you know. But he who walks with the wise will himself be wise. But a companion of fools comes to what? He will be destroyed. I don't know about you, but I don't want to be destroyed. So that means that I have to choose the right company in my life because if I choose the wrong company, it will distract me from my destiny and eventually I'll be on a path to ruin. But we in our lives have the opportunity to choose the right people. How do we choose the right company? Number one, they aren't just kiss-ups. Number two, we're better when they're around. Number three is we see the outcome of our lives. Very important, the people that we surround ourselves because evil company corrupts good character. Did you guys get something from the word tonight? Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise. Glory to God. I want to talk to you guys before you leave this place. Last thing I want to do for tonight. I want to just get your attention. Okay, so turn off the cell phones. Give me a couple more minutes of your attention. Vitally important for somebody in this room. Because I want to make sure before you leave this place that your heart's right with God. It'd be a tragedy if we came together and had such a good time in the Lord. Some of you guys got miracles tonight. It's awesome. Saw it right before your eyes. Some of you guys got touched by the Lord. Some of you guys heard the word of the Lord. Be a tragedy if we did all that, laughed together, sang together, cried together, do all that, and then we let you go, and your heart's not right with God. And God forbid this should be anyone's fate tonight, but if it was your last night here on the earth, whether Jesus came home or whether you died and you went to hell. Now, sometimes people get offended when we start talking in terms like that. They say, hell, oh gosh, you know, you preachers, you just love talking about, why are you so mean-spirited? You know, and you make God out to be this mean egotist who just sends people to hell. And yet, can I tell you something? I love you enough to tell you the truth. I'm not playing games tonight. This is not something that I like. No one likes talking about hell. Not even the people who preach. But I have to talk about it. Just like a doctor who would have to talk to their patient about their diagnosis, what they see. Just like somebody looking at a little child on the freeway and seeing a big truck coming at them. They wouldn't say, oh, honey, please get out of the street. Come down off of the freeway overpass. There's something coming for you that you don't want to meet up with. No, they'd say, little kid, get off the road, get down here, and don't you realize you shouldn't be playing in the street? You could have got leveled by a Mack truck. You'd be a little pancake on the road. And yet, when preachers start talking about hell, people say, oh, no, I don't want to have anything to do with that. And yet, there's a truck coming for you. And tonight, I love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. Just by burying your head in the sand and saying, I don't believe hell's real or it's a fairy tale or whatever you think, doesn't make it go away. God talks about hell all throughout the Bible, Old and New Testament. Jesus himself spoke about hell. So it's a very real place. And I want to make sure you don't go there. God wants to make sure you don't go there. God loves you so much, he sent Jesus, beaten, bloody, hung on a cross. Public spectacle, so that you and I didn't have to go to hell. And yet God loves us enough also to allow us the free will choice while we're here on the earth to choose where we go, whether we go to heaven or whether we go to hell. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, all roads lead to heaven. I don't have to worry about hell because all roads lead to heaven. You do your thing, I'll do my thing. I appreciate what you're trying to do. But you know, the churches out there, they all have their own way, and everybody will get there somehow, some way. And yet, can I tell you something? If we applied that logic to the earth, you'd think we were crazy, right? What if I told you, hey, all roads lead to the moon. You want to go to the moon? Just drive around the earth. You'll make it there eventually. You'd say, that's just wrong. You can drive around the earth as long as you want, and you'll never make it. So what makes us think we can do whatever we want to do and make it to heaven? See, it's God's heaven. You got to get there God's way. Jesus said, wide is the way that leads to destruction, and narrow is the way to heaven, and there are few who find it. So we need to endeavor to enter by that narrow way. Jesus said, I am that way. I am the truth and I am the life. No man goes to the Father except by me. That means it's God's heaven. We're going to have to get there God's way. Now, sometimes people say, well, Pastor, that's good news because I've been a really good person. Done a lot of good deeds throughout my lifetime. Yeah, I used to be bad. Cleaned up my act. Now I'm good. And I've, you know, helped people out, given money to charities, gotten involved in social justice causes. I've been a really good person. Doesn't that mean that I'm going to get to go to heaven because I've been good enough? Well, the problem is, could you show me in the Bible how good you have to be? Is there a grading scale behind the maps? Is there a curve or a line you have to be above? Can you tell me how good, or maybe does God say, just let your good outweigh your bad and you get to go to heaven or clean up your act? Let me tell you what the Bible does say. The Bible does say that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. No one is perfect. We've all messed up. We've all done things that we know we should not have done. We've all have transgressed God's laws. And if we're trying to get into heaven based on our goodness, the standard is perfection. And there's only one who is perfect. His name is Jesus. So that means we're not going to make it. In fact, our goodness compared to God's goodness, the Bible says, like filthy rags. It means they're going to get thrown out. Not going to make it to heaven just by being good. Sometimes people say, well, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. I've always considered myself to be a Christian. I wore a cross or St. Christopher from the time I was young. Baptized or christened as a child. Went to religious classes like Sunday school or catechism class. Born in America, America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslims, Hindus. Therefore, we're Christians headed for heaven, denying hell, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents raise you in church, tell you you're Christian, that makes you Christian? Or because you attend religious classes, wear religious jewelry, be baptized or christened as a child, or be born in America, that you get to go to heaven? It doesn't work like that. And nowhere, check it out, nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're not some other religion, that by default, God lumps you into the category of being a Christian, headed for heaven, denying your presence in hell. Tonight, let me love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. Come on, give me a couple more minutes of your attention. Your eternal life is at stake right now. And I want to make sure that you go to heaven and that you don't end up in hell. Some of you might be thinking, well, Pastor, not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now, and I call myself a Christian. I'm a Christian. But you know, it doesn't matter how many titles we give ourselves or where we sit, because if I told you, I really want to be a fish, and I'm going to go in the ocean, sit in the water, and call myself a fish, you know what? I could sit there as long as I want, and that will never make me a fish. You know what it'll make me? Is a slimy, pruny human being after a while. But I will never be a fish. So you can't just sit in church service, call yourself a Christian. That makes you a Christian. It doesn't work like that. So you might be thinking, Pastor, I understand that, but hold on a second. You don't understand. My last church I got involved, I helped out. I sang in the choir, carried the pastor's Bible, made decisions in that church. People thought of me as a leader. I even got a membership card to that church. That's great. I'm glad you did those things. But now aren't we back to good works again? Aren't we back to trying to earn your way into heaven by what you do? God's not looking for a volunteer hour sheet or your membership card before you can enter the gates of heaven. It doesn't work like that. You say, ah, Pastor, okay, I know how it works. Someone told me that if I knew God, I'm a Christian. I know God. I know about Jesus. Sing the songs at Christmas, celebrate the resurrection at Easter every year of my life. I could quote scriptures to you, Pastor, Old and New Testament. I could do that. Doesn't that mean that I'm a Christian? Well, the problem with that is if you'd read your Bible, you know the demons believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. They're not Christians. If you'd read your Bible, you know the devil himself knows who Jesus is and believes that he is the Son of God. And yet, even though he knows him, and even though the devil can quote scriptures, you read that, that doesn't qualify him for heaven. So everybody look up here at me for a second. It's not about what you have in your head. It's not about having mental assent towards God, knowing who Jesus is, and that gets you right with God. But rather, it's about your heart. God's always been after your heart. All the way through the Bible, Old and New Testament, God is looking for your heart. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Jesus was speaking to a religious leader of his day who was a good guy, did a lot of good deeds. We would have thought if anyone was going to heaven, it'd be this guy. But Jesus doesn't tell him, hey, your good works or your church attendance or your involvement or sitting in church or any of that kind of stuff. He doesn't say any of that stuff gets him into heaven. He says, you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. Now, I know our society's made a mockery out of that term. They've raked through the coals, made it out to be something that it's not. But let's not let society, movies, Hollywood, television, books, and the internet describe for us what being born again is. Let's find out from the Bible. What does being born again really mean from the Bible? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, always meant the same thing. It means that you've given God all of your heart, and you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. Like I said, it's all or nothing with Jesus. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to a church just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. And he says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Now, those are pretty gross and graphic words from the mouth of Jesus, but what's he saying, lukewarm? What's that all about? It's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token of prayer every now and then. Occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. And you're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, you're not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. Listen, what's Jesus saying? In or out. Either you are or you aren't. Don't patty cake, play games, and think you're going to get to make it. This is all or nothing with Jesus Christ. In a moment, I'm going to give you an opportunity to do just that. If you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus, or maybe at one point you said you had, but you fell away, backslid, and you say, man, I really need to go for God. I'm lukewarm, and I need to do this. Here's the opportunity in a moment. I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. When I say three, I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang. When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang, that's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart, I want to give God all my life, I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up, I'll count it, you can put it right back down. Now you might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second, time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, you might be. Let's get over that. Because think of the trade-off. Isn't it better to be embarrassed for a moment than it is to end up in hell forever and ever and ever and ever? No one make that trade. Yeah, you might be thinking, well, Pastor, I feel like you're pushing me. Yeah, I am. You know why? Because the devil's on the other side pushing just as hard. When he lets up, I will. But guess what? He's not letting up. And therefore, I'm coming after you all the more. Why? Because I love you. Why? Because God loves you. Why? Because Jesus went to the cross so that you didn't have to go to hell, but that you could go to heaven with him forever and ever. Man, that's awesome. All he's asking for you is to give him all of your heart and all of your life. Who should raise your hand in a moment if you've been running from God instead of to God? I'm speaking to you. Who should raise your hand if you're not sure? Make sure. Who should raise your hand if you've never done this, never said yes to Jesus? I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise your hand? You look warm. You know that's the condition of your heart when I described it. You ready to get your hand up? all across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe, or online, wherever you're at, all over the world. God sees. God's watching. And then right afterwards, you can click the button that says Respond to God. It's a blue button. Or you can go to our homepage and find the tab that says How to Know God, and someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. Come on. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go, all together. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, you need to give God all of your heart. You need to give God all of your life. There's one. There's two back in the family room. I got you over there. There's three up there. God bless you. On this side, there's three wise people. There's four over there. Got you. Thank you. God bless you. Who else? So I know there's more than four people in here that need to give their heart and life to Jesus. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should go for it. Thank you over there. Five. Got you. God bless you. Who else tonight? Saying, I need to give God all my heart. Need to give God all my life. Come on. Come on. You know, the greatest person you can align yourself with. Remember, distraction from destiny. The greatest person who can take you on your way to destiny. The only one who can take you there. His name is Jesus. Anybody else? Where are you at? It's raised up high for me. Up here. Got you. Two more right there. Thank you. God bless you. Five, six, seven. All right. Who else? Who else tonight? Saying, yeah, I need to link up with Jesus. Need to ally myself with him. Need to connect with him because I've been going my own way or I've been going the devil's way. I need to stop and I need to go his way. Need to go on the way to destiny. Anybody else real quick tonight? Anybody else? There's seven wise people. Come on, number eight, number nine, number 10. You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, yeah, you should go for it. Come on. If that's you, just raise it up high for me. Anybody else real quick? Anybody else? Come on, let's go for God tonight. If that's you, just raise it up high. Anybody else? All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for seven wise people. Hallelujah. All right, all seven of you, or if you're number 8, 9, and 10, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. It's not too late. In a moment, we're all going to stand, give a clap and a shout. All right, Reverend Joe's going to lead us in a song. As you hear that, that's your cue. Get your stuff, whatever you brought with you to church. Get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. Once you get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that till we get you down here. So let's all stand and welcome them. And you come right now. If you raised your hand, you should have raised your hand. Come on down to the front right now. Come on, let's give them a hand. Come on, they're coming. You can come too. You can come too. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. From the family rooms, if you raised your hand or your children did, bring them down right now. They'll remember this. Anybody else if you need to come? They're still coming. Come on. You can come too. Hallelujah, they're still coming. They're still coming. Come on, this is your time. This is your moment. From the foyer, if you walked out and you need to walk back in, come on, be bold enough to do that right now. Come on into the church service. Anybody else, if you need to come, come on down. All right, you guys, came to give God all of your heart, came to give God all of your life. Thank God you guys have come. Hey, listen, I love you, all right? Maybe you haven't heard that today. But I love you. And guess what? This church does too. We're very excited about your new life with God. God's got great things ahead of each and every one of you. All right? I want to introduce you guys to a friend. Remember we talked about who you connect with tonight? Right over here is a friend. His name's Pastor Joel. Really good guy. Nothing weird goes on. About as weird as you're going to encounter tonight. He's cool. He's going to do three things. He's going to, number one, lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus into your heart. Secondly, he's going to give you some free information, some free literature. Now that you're a Christian, what do you do next? Okay? Help you to find out. Now, what do I do? Okay, I'll give you a hint. One of the things is get back to church as often as you can, all right? That'll help you, okay? And then thirdly, he's going to introduce you to a program we have called Spiritual Personal Trainers. It's a friend in church, someone who will come alongside you, encourage you, like we talked about tonight. And they'll teach you five things out of the Bible, help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. So you don't go back to your old ways. You don't go back serving the devil. You go on with your new family, with your new father, God, Jesus, all right? You get to grow in his ways. Now, he'll describe how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out in the church service. Your friends and family will wait for you. Now, give us a year, guys. okay? Consistently sitting under the teaching here at The Rock. If you can do Wednesday nights, that's cool. Maybe you can add Sunday mornings to that, or Saturday morning at 10, or Sunday night at 6, okay? Whatever you can get as much as you can. All right? And after that year and for the rest of your life, you will say, my goodness, I'm so blessed. I didn't know it could be like this. Am I telling the truth, everybody? All right, take their word for it, okay? It all starts with that friend, that spiritual personal trainer who will help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. He'll describe how that works, and then he'll let you come right back out. So if you guys will make a left turn and follow Pastor Joel right this way, come on, let's give him a hand as they go. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow. You repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son, and that you sent him for me, and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to The Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.